next few moments are devoted to silent prayer. That gives each one of you as a believer priest the privacy of your priesthood to rebound if necessary. For if we name our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to purify us from all wrongdoing. When we name our sins to God, we are filled with God the Holy Spirit. God the Holy Spirit is our mentor and our teacher, and the one who brings to our memory those things we've forgotten. So with that in mind, let us pray. Father, we thank you for the wonderful privilege and freedom to assemble ourselves together for the purpose of learning your word. May God the Holy Spirit enlighten us, and may we have the concentration necessary to assimilate this portion of the Word of God into our stream of consciousness. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Well, it's all over the news today concerning Obamacare, and particularly with Ted Cruz of Texas, a statesman. He utilized a form of what is called the filibuster, and he spoke for 22 hours straight to try and stop this monstrosity of socialism, which is antithetical to everything related to divine establishment principles and capitalism. Capitalism has brought about the greatest health care ever known to man, and it's being wiped out as I speak. And that's part of the third cycle of discipline. Now that man as a statesman is doing his best. But we're not going to find a solution through politics. Not anymore. And that man before has even said what this nation really needs, Ted Cruz, is a spiritual revival. He's right on concerning that. I don't know what church he attends or anything like that, but he's right on when he says this country needs a spiritual revival. And there is a function of a believer, if he's in politics, to be a statesman and not a politician. And that's exactly what he's done. But I'm sure you've heard all about that. I'm going to read from the Washington Examiner. It says this. Today, this is out of Tennessee. Today, a 27-year-old man in Memphis can buy a plan for as low as $41 a month. On the exchange, the lowest state average is $119 a month, a 190% increase. Today, a 27-year-old woman in Nashville can also buy a plan for as low as $58 a month. On the exchange, the lowest price plan in Nashville is $114 a month, a 97% increase. Even with a tax subsidy, that plan is $104 a month, almost twice what she could pay today. Today, women in Nashville can choose from 30 insurance plans that cost less than the administration says insurance plans on the exchange will cost, even with the new tax subsidy. In Nashville, 105 insurance plans offered today will not be available in the exchange. This is what one Republican senator said, quote, "Why should a 27-year-old male in Memphis be forced to pay nearly three times more than what he pays today for health insurance? Why should a young woman in Nashville have to pay twice as much? This isn't what the president promised Tennesseans. But it's what he's giving them, higher costs, and less choice. That are two of the most urgent reasons Obamacare must be repealed and our health care system fixed." Well, our health care system, the only problem with our health care system as far as fixing it is to get the government out of it and to stop inflating prices by subsidizing everything. The only thing we really need to fix health care is capitalism. And you say, well, what about the poor? Look, no poor person's ever been denied coverage. And if they go to the hospital, they have to be treated, period. And then if they don't pay, guess what? Charity has been taking up the slack. And that's the way it's been in our history. Now you say, but the cost keeps going up. Yes, The more government subsidizes something, the more it's going to cost. What we really need to go to is a simple thing to where when you have to go to the doctor, you pay for it. And what you should be able to buy is simple catastrophic insurance to where if you have to go to the doctor and let's say the bill's going to be over $10,000, then the insurance will cover it after that. And you will see health prices plummet in the marketplace. You'll even be able to shop for a cheaper doctor. Now, this stuff going on now is going to destroy the greatest healthcare system in the world. And it has, and you're going to blame the politicians, or you're going to blame wherever you work, but you don't place blame. The blame rests with believers who have failed to execute the protocol plan of God, and as a result, this country is being brought to its knees. We were never designed to function under socialism, but that's exactly where we've gone. And it's evil. It's totally satanic. Everything this country is doing is backwards. Everything that we should be doing that is right according to divine establishment, we are doing the opposite. In my generation and people younger, and even the older people, they're going to have to make a decision. But once you get older, you get set in your ways. So it's really going to be left up to my generation and those younger, and they are have been so indoctrinated, it's going to take tragedy to wake them up. And boy, are they ever going to see it. You have no idea as I speak today. I've seen it coming for a long time, and you're going to realize it. Here's another article by Winton Hall. Andy and Amy Mangione of Louisville, looks like a French name, of Louisville, Kentucky, say their health insurance nearly tripled overnight from $333 a month to $965 due to Obamacare. When I saw, this is quoting the family, when I saw the letter when I came home from work, it said, "Your action required. Benefit changes. Act now." Of course, I opened it immediately, said Andy Mangione. Or it's spelled M-A-N-G-I-O-N-E, however you want to pronounce that. So Andy told Fox News veteran reporter Jim Angle that nothing had changed about the health of his wife, himself, or their two boys. Quote, "This is a high deductible plan where I'm assuming a lot of risk for my health insurance for my family," he told Fox News. "And nothing has changed. Our boys are healthy. They're young. My wife is healthy. I'm healthy. Nothing in our medical history has changed to warrant a tripling of our premiums." Andy's insurance company, Humana, declined to comment. Humana did, however, include the following explanation in the rate spike announcement letter. Quote, "If your policy premium increased, you should know this isn't unique to Humana premium increases, as they generally will occur industry-wide. Increases aren't based on your individual claims or changes in health status. Many other factors go into your premium, including ACA, the Affordable Health Care Act, also known as Obamacare, compliance, including the addition of new essential health benefits. Obamacare's government health care exchanges go live nationwide in 6 days. So if you haven't gotten your, from your company, what's going to happen, something similar to that could very well happen to you. And in fact, I was looking at some graphs. Ohio is going to be one of the states hit the hardest for some reason. I don't know why, but according to the graph, on average, there's going to be an 80% increase in health care premiums for Ohioans. And of course, those who are working and making money will pay a lot more, as they will not have the subsidy. So you can see it go up 100% easily. Well, all of this is happening because of the fact that believers in this country failed the prosperity test. We went many, many years in prosperity, and as a result, a lot of people have drifted away from Bible doctrine. And as a result, we have the third cycle of discipline, And it's going to intensify. In fact, this is the worst economy that we've had statistically since the Great Depression. It's worse than the 70s, and as being the longest drawn-out time of poor economic growth. The only time it's been worse was under Roosevelt. Well, turn in your Bibles to Hosea chapter 4. This tells the reason, and it tells what's going to happen. The good thing about Hosea is, due to his ministry, and due to the fact people went positive, Israel did not go out under the fifth cycle of discipline. They woke up as they were going through the third cycle. Hosea chapter 4. Now, as I told you, there's two ways punishment can go for a country, just as it does for a people. You either come out for punishment better than before, that is, you rebound and keep moving, or you come out from punishment worse than before, that is, you have a self-pity reaction, and you continue along the same lines, and you turn toward man for an answer. And that's exactly the design of socialism, and that's exactly the design of Saul Alinsky, of which our president is well read in his schemes in how to radicalize a nation or turn it from capitalist to socialist. And all you have to do is read his own book. But from Saul Alinsky, it's very easy to go in a capitalist society that has degenerated and has no pivot, because all you have to do is point your finger at someone else, blame them for all that's going on, and say, you know what, we need to fix this. And the answer becomes more and more government. Now, that's when punishment doesn't work. When punishment does work, the people turn back to divine establishment principles, and they do so through the blessing by association of those who have reached maturity. And in this country today, we have the biggest collection of baby believers and negative believers who could give, who don't care one bit about the Word of God. And as a result, it's going to make you cuss. I about slipped up myself there, but oh well. Hosea, a lot of people are going to be cussing, and it's going to be acceptable, believe you me. But it's not going to be acceptable. It's called complaining. I'm not complaining. I'm just giving you as it is. Hosea chapter 4. Hear the word of the Lord, you Israelites. Well, this message is from the Word of God, so it applies to us, so you can easily say, hear the word of the Lord, you people of these United States of America, because the Lord has a charge to bring against you who live in the land. There is no faithfulness. No faithfulness toward God's word. No love. No acknowledgement of God in the land. That is, no acknowledgement of divine establishment principles. There is only cursing, lying and murder, stealing and adultery. They break all bounds. And this has to do, of course, the cursing has to do with verbal sins, gossip, maligning, and judging. It doesn't have to do with cursed words. In fact, they didn't speak English when this was written. It was written in Hebrew. And there are quite a few curse words in the Bible, is what we would consider curse words. Cursing has to do with verbal sin. Gossip, maligning, and judging. There is only gossip, maligning, and judging. There is lying before a court of law and murder. Just look at Chicago and Detroit. Stealing and adultery. All of these things go against the divine establishment principles. Thou shalt not steal. Divine establishment principle. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Divine establishment principle. For believer and unbeliever, by the way. Thou shalt not murder. Divine establishment principle. You cannot give false witness in court, commit perjury. For believer and unbeliever. And a ceasing of the verbal sins. And that too, that goes along with the fact that verbal sins, of course, are the worst kind of sins, but when you have an environment of a pivot of mature believers, there is even a holdback on that, due to the fact that the authority is good. In other words, authority in the workplace is good authority, and it won't allow that type of bickering and backstabbing. But today, it's very much allowed in our country. So this looks pretty much like these United States of America. Then it goes, and bloodshed follows bloodshed. And we see murders every day in this country. And it's always coming across the news. And they use that to go against our freedom and blame it on a gun instead of on a person. And that's pretty stupid. But people don't have any knowledge, so a lot of people go along with it. Because of this, the land dries up. Well, this is an agricultural economy, and when there's no rain, there's no crops. And since this is an industrialized country, when there's no industry, there's no jobs. So, by way of analogy, it lines up with what's going on here. All the jobs dry up, and all who live in it waste away. They became so poor they were starving. The beasts of the fields, the birds in the sky, and the fish in the sea are swept away. And that has to do with the fact that under God's punishment, a lot of industry in Israel had to do with the fishing industry. Well, they couldn't even catch fish anymore. The schools of fish moved away. And the birds in the sky, well, even they left because the land is so parched. And the beast couldn't even live there because the land was so parched. And that's all that refers to. And then in verse 4, but let no one bring a charge. Let no one accuse another. For your people are like those who bring charges against a priest. Now the priest in those days, in Hosea's day, would be the national leaders. And so what did they do? Well, when the times got bad and the drought came, they all started pointing their fingers at each other. The priest of one party started pointing their fingers at a priest of another party, and the priest of the other party pointed their fingers at the priest of that party, and the people all pointed their fingers at both parties. And so they're all bringing charges against a priest. But what's the Bible say? Let no one bring a charge. And why not? It's because of this. Verse 5, you stumble day and night, and the prophets stumble with you. Well, this has to do with the fact that the people are not learning Bible doctrine, and the prophets themselves, who should be teaching Bible doctrine, aren't teaching it. So that has to do with the fact that the blind is leading the blind. So I will destroy your mother. That's an idiom for I will destroy your country. And then in verse 6 is the reason. My people are destroyed from lack of knowledge. Lack of knowledge of Bible doctrine. No pivot. Furthermore, lack of knowledge of divine establishment. But if you have a pivot, the other falls into place. But we're losing out on divine establishment because of no pivot. None whatsoever in this country. Just a very few pleroma believers are holding this country by a thread. But we're going out. I mean, it's third cycle all the way, pedal to the metal. There's no way you can get away with the things that we're doing. Even basic laws of economy won't allow it. Even the Russians have told us, you can't keep going like this. The Chinese have told us, even our enemies, well, you can't do this. And in fact, they're getting a little nervous about it themselves because the dollar is the gold standard of the world. And when we start printing money, we are stealing from the world. And they note to us, look, if you keep going in this direction, you're going to cause widespread famine in many parts of the world because they depend on the dollar and it's crashing and they're not going to be able to afford food in other areas of the world, and it might even spread here. And even our enemies don't like what they're seeing from the United States, because they know as we go, so go they. And if they happen to pull the rug out from under us, they know it will destabilize the world. It's the only reason why they haven't. They can all of a sudden say, you know what, the dollar is no longer the gold standard. And they might say, well, let's go with the Chinese yen or yuan. But they don't do that because China is, even though their economy is growing, it's very unstable, even compared with the United States, because of all the number of people there, and the fact that actually they have to have about 10% growth just to keep up with their population. So if it falls below that, the Communist Party there is in trouble. But if they ever do decide to go to a different common currency, they could put in a basket a whole bunch of different currencies and say, this is the gold standard, and that'll be the end of the dollar. And that will be such a hyperinflation. All of you would have a stroke if you could see what was coming. Instead, let's learn some doctrine so you'll be able to handle what's going to occur. But don't bring a charge. You know, everybody's going to want to blame the politicians that they elected. No. Don't bring a charge. Because my people are destroyed from lack of knowledge. Because you have rejected knowledge, I also reject you as my priests. That is, I reject you as a client nation to God. Because you have ignored the doctrine of your God, I also will ignore your children. And this has to do with the fact that when society starts to go under, we always talk about our children. And every time there's a degeneracy, people want to say, well, we can't do this. We can't go to war. What about our children? We can't, like the Israelites did in the Exodus generation. Well, God says, hey, you better get with doctrine or I'll ignore your children. Well, if you're with doctrine, you don't have to be concerned except to keep on moving, because you're going to need every ounce of it to get through the hard times that are ahead. And the real problem that we are facing in this country, as far as believers are concerned, is the fact that they failed the prosperity test. And the reason why you fail the prosperity test has everything to do with distractions. Distractions. And you're distracted from your Christian way of life. You're distracted from the spiritual life. And there are reasons for this distraction. Number one, you could just have negative volition to Bible doctrine. That is a distraction, obviously. You have lack of spiritual self-esteem. And if you don't have spiritual self-esteem, you will become a hypersensitive person. And everything will be about you. You won't be able to adjust to anything in life because you think the whole world revolves around you. But under spiritual self-esteem, you know better. You know that everything revolves around Jesus Christ, and you have a personal sense of destiny to be occupied with the person of Jesus Christ. But instead, you become subjective, which means you are the subject, and everything around you, you relate to yourself, which makes you highly hypersensitive, which is arrogance. You're always hypersensitive about what people are saying about you, thinking about you. If someone wrongs you for real, or if you perceive that someone has wronged you, or if you don't think you're getting enough attention, well, you just fly off the handle. That's subjective arrogance. And that means lack of spiritual self-esteem. And spiritual self-esteem is often confused with arrogance, but that's just from the people in life who don't understand the confidence related to the Word of God. And it also has to do with projection. People project onto others the very things that they're involved in. there are some people. Well, Billy Graham, he has a thing. I've visited something on his website, and he too is concerned about our country, though he's 94, 5. He's on up there. He recently had a birthday. I've forgotten his age. He's in his 90s. And, yeah, I do know his birthday is November 7th. The same as my dad's and the same as a guy I know named Gary, I think. His is the same day, right? Yep. Well, that goes to show you that date doesn't mean much. I'm just playing. But Billy Graham came out of that. And, well, he had a lot to say about the country and such as that. But one of the things that he has said is that he's always thought that he didn't go far enough in his own spiritual life. And when he was asked, what is the most difficult thing for you to deal with? A long time ago he was asked this by Larry King. What is the most difficult thing for you to deal with as in a famous evangelist? He said pride, getting your eyes on all the fame and all the people and all that. And that's understandable. And he seems like a very humble man in that way, and to recognize that that can be a problem. And with every visible spiritual gift, that can be a problem, as far as trying to promote yourself or making it about you instead of about Christ. But it was John the Baptizer who was very visible. He said, I must decrease and Christ must increase, which indicates what the attitude of the pastor should be. It's not about the pastor, it's about Jesus Christ. It's only about the pastor in that he should teach Bible doctrine. And I don't do this for any type of self-aggrandizement. That would be ridiculous. In fact, you get more arrows when you teach Bible doctrine. You get more arrows slung at you than if you were to go into a apostasy. And if you go into apostasy, the people love that because we're in apostasy as a country. And a lot of pastors have gone astray because they start looking at their finances and they say, these sheep aren't paying enough. Well, sheep never do. And then they look at the fact that their congregation doesn't grow. Well, sheep don't like to be chewed out. And then they start thinking about all the praise they're missing out on. And so they start to go astray from doctrine. That's a distraction, a terrible distraction. In fact, if you look back at Hosea chapter 4, you will see that as it continues, it says, even as the priests increase, their sins increase. And what that means is, for our country, to bring it into the church age, even as the numbers of pastors increase, the amount of apostasy increases with it, because the pastors aren't teaching Bible doctrine. And there are a lot of pastors out there. There are a lot of churches all across this land. There's a church and a liquor store and a church and a liquor store all across the land, especially down south, even up north. There's a church right across the way there. And I can drive a little bit further, and there's another church right across here. All different types of churches. Lots and lots of pastors. And are they teaching the Word of God? Well, I don't know what they're teaching around here, but I seriously doubt it. And the reason is they're in apostasy along with the congregations. And all that becomes is a social club where people get together and have a social life with other believers. I always remember a tape that I heard many years ago. A pastor wrote into the colonel and said, you know, I'm a pastor. I was listening to your tapes and I got saved. And then I started thinking, well, I need to teach what you're teaching. He was a pastor, wasn't even saved. Guess what? There's a lot of those out there too. But you never know who's saved and who's not. That's another thing I was thinking about last night. I was watching, or the night before, I was watching Fox News, and they had a priest on there and another guy, and both of them were talking about the new book Bill O'Reilly is coming out with called Killing Jesus, and both of them were talking about how in O'Reilly's book, O'Reilly makes it clear that Jesus Christ said, "I am the Son of God," and makes no bones about it. And both the guys there, the Catholic priest and the other guy, was probably a Protestant of some denomination. Definitely a Protestant. I don't know what other denomination. See, a Protestant is someone who protested the Catholic Church. If you're not a Catholic, you're a Protestant. And if you're Lutheran, you're a Protestant. You know, if you're not Catholic, but you're a believer, you're a Protestant. Well, both of those were believers, even though one was a Catholic and one was a Protestant, because the Catholic priest said, yes, and you have to believe in Jesus Christ, and some people will read this and believe in Christ, and some people will reject it. So that's pretty good for a Catholic priest. He's saved, and so was the Protestant, and they said believe. Both of them said believe. I didn't hear invite. That was a relief. It's a relief to be away from that mess, too, where all that goes on, that invite stuff. How nauseating. Well, that's the reason why the country's going under. They don't even know how to give the gospel straight anymore. And it all has to do with, so I'm talking about the pastor teacher and the distractions he'll face. I know some pastors from time to time come by and listen to my messages. So as an encouragement to you, yeah, we all face that problem. Where's our next paycheck coming from? What can I do to get this message out there? It's so important, but nobody seems to want it. Nobody seems fired up about it, and it's very discouraging. Everywhere in the country, it's discouraging. Well, guess what? Just keep plowing forward. If you have to work with your own hands, work with your own hands. Do what you have to do. Keep going. Don't neglect your gift. The verse in the Bible says, do not neglect your gift. And if you just can't make it and you say, you know, there's nobody here to support what I'm doing, and therefore I've got to work 40 hours a week, and I just don't have the capability, and I'm too tired, well, you can quit, because God factors takes into consideration the very fact that the country's in apostasy. I've made a personal choice. I'm not going to quit. Just not going to. And if I have to be a wolf crying in the wilderness, I'll be a wolf crying in the wilderness. I will not quit until God makes me quit. Sometimes he does that for good reason. But ignorance or failure to use the problem-solving devices, that's also something that leads to a distraction. You can be distracted by legalism. And the legalist always assumes that he's very spiritual and goes into moral degeneracy. I have a whole series on legalism, by the way, 8 messages that run in tandem with this, if you're interested. So I won't talk too much about that, since you can go there and hear all about the legalist in that area. But they are very distracted and blinded. And oftentimes they think that because they use a simple language that they consider holy, that they are just great. And all they do is say amen and hallelujah. Well, they think that's grand. Well, you know, it's not. I can say that. I know you don't think I'm grand. Amen, hallelujah, praise the Lord. I'm going to rise up. I could really become apostate all of a sudden. I have a lot more people listening, but no. I don't care about that. Look, if I want to make money, I'll make it in a different way. Or, you know, I'd rather get a job, a real job. Not some fake thing where I'm extorting money from people and not giving them something as to how it is. I wouldn't even know how to do that. There's a distraction as far as Christian service. And part of that for the pastor, I guess we'll be doing this tomorrow as well. So I'll just continue with the problems a pastor faces. Yeah, you teach doctrine, you're going to get arrows slung at you. Well, that's a test. Pass it. Grow in grace and in knowledge like you're supposed to, and ignore it. Hey, all you have to do is understand the concept of Matthew chapter 7 and triple compound discipline. And you know, as a pastor, that you receive double the blessing, double the punishment. So if you are, you know, if people are throwing arrows at you, You could screw up and mess up, and then people, oh, look at that. And guess what? They receive the punishment for whatever sin you committed that they found out about. Or, furthermore, they will receive the punishment, and you will get right off the hook of punishment. That's all found in Matthew 7. That's the justice of God, by the way, because guess what? The person who judged you just took the robe off of God and the gavel. And not only that, they named your sin. Now let's say you're not guilty. Let's say somebody says, oh, you're just in it for approbation lust. You want praise and you want attention and you want this and that. Well, guess what? And you say, but no, my motivation's pure. Well, they get punished for naming a sin that you didn't commit, and then you get blessed, but you get double the blessing. They get double the curse. And that's sad for them, but it's good for you. You just keep right on moving. And don't let these, don't get your eyes on people. You know, it's the same for a pastor as everyone else. Don't get your eyes on people. Don't get your eyes on the congregation. Keep your eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't get your eyes on what people are saying about you. Don't get your eyes on what other pastors are saying about you. You just keep right on moving. As long as you're doing your work is unto the Lord. You're doing just fine. You say, but I don't know that much, and I don't seem to know as much as you know, or I don't seem to know as much as the pastor before you. I don't seem to know as much as Colonel Thiemna. Well, guess what? Join the crowd. So what? You just keep right on plugging, and you keep right on teaching. You'll keep right on learning, and you'll keep right on teaching. Because Colonel Thiem's not everybody's right pastor. I'm definitely not everybody's right pastor. And there's a right pastor who's teaching doctrine for, and God has sent to you people. He's assigned to you people for a certain time. And the people may stay, and they may seem real hot for doctrine. They might stay a month and leave. So what? That's going to happen. People are going to come and go. People are going to seem rah-rah for you, and then suddenly they're going to seem as if you're their enemy. You can't get your eyes on that. Otherwise, you will fail. And that is true failure. Yeah, people are twisted in their view of what failure is. They say, you don't have a large congregation. You're a failure. No. Oftentimes, having a large congregation means you are a failure. That doesn't have anything to do with it. Don't even worry about numbers. Don't worry about numbers. Don't worry about the numbers in your checkbook either. Because you cannot be a great leader and be worried about money. It's you cannot be a spiritual leader and be worried about money. So if you're worried about money, and you're thinking you're going to extract it from a church, well, quit. Because you're not. And if you do, you're in the wrong. That should not be your motivation. My pastor, it took him 10 years before he even had any type of income to support himself. He supported himself with his own income from whatever happened previously. Worked with his own hands, etc., had his own savings. For 10 years, he had enough saved up where he didn't need that much of an income. And just imagine, the greatest pastor of our, well, since Paul, as far as I'm concerned, had to go 10 years without a paycheck. But he did it. Thank God he did it. And it was that faithfulness that I want to follow, just as Paul's faithfulness that I want to follow. And yeah, I do quote the Colonel quite often. I'm smart for doing so. He's the best. Why wouldn't I? So what? I don't get paid to do it. But I still have the gift of pastor teaching. And you'll get, if I'm your right pastor, you'll get something out of it different than if you were listening to Colonel Thiem. And by the way, he's already not known very much anymore anyway. So you just keep right on plugging on, plugging on. There's a reason why you were born as a pastor during this time in history. You are a current event right now. And your purpose is to edify the church. And if I can impart to you some fire to keep doing that, well, I do understand it's difficult to study and teach. Keep on it. Our country needs it. You need it. We all need it. So don't be distracted by these things. Don't be distracted by your lust pattern of the sin nature. I'm away from the past. I'm talking in general now. Pastor's class is over. There's distractions related to carnality. That is, you could succumb to your lust pattern. Maybe you have power lust. That might be your area of weakness. So you get distracted there. You might have approbation lust, so you get distracted there. You might be in competition with another believer or have some type of excessive ambition. And that means that that's part of your lust pattern. And you can get distracted there. Or money, monetary lust. That's an understandable one, and people do it. All of these are understandable as far as a lust pattern. Sexual lust, you can get distracted by that. David got distracted by that. His son Solomon got distracted by that. Since men were a lot of the visible heroes in the Old Testament, you hear a lot about them. But women are the same. You have Mary Magdalene. She had a lust for sexual pleasure, and she got caught in adultery. And a lot of women, there were prostitutes all throughout the Bible. So there's sexual lust. Pleasure lust, just in general. Whatever, you're distracted by all the pleasures of life. A lover of pleasure rather than a lover of God. Now, I like and love pleasure, but I don't love it to the exclusion of Bible doctrine. There's a revenge lust, that's part of hatred. A crusader lust, trying to change the world through the energy of the flesh. A social lust, trying to climb the social ladder. Trying to become, and people get involved in this, especially if they start making lots of money. They want to join the highest achieving club, etc. Some type of social climb. I was watching Larry the Cable Guy, and part of being wealthy was doing some kind of horse thing. What'd they call that? Hit this ball around with the horse. Polo. And he was talking about the membership there. The fee was $4 million or something. It's some ridiculous number just to play some polo. Well, people have their things that they enjoy, but I think something like that is just an idiot trying to climb a social ladder, because you're paying $4 million to hit a ball around on a horse. Shoot, I should make one for poor people and charge them $100 or something if it's that big a deal, but nobody even likes that stupid game. So I think that's part of the social climb. Not for all of them, but a lot of them. That's what it's all about, to be part of that exclusive club. Now, if I were going to be part of an exclusive club with a lot of money, it would be an airplane club. And not to climb a social ladder, but to be able to fly. For example, there's this guy who formed this social club. He's got an airfield in the North Carolina mountains at about 5,000 feet. Well, you're not going to fly there too often because of the wind, but during some nice, cool fall days, to see the colors and to land there in your own nice airplane, that sounds like a good club to me. But this is there is a social lust and a chemical lust, a lust for drugs and lust for excessive alcohol. Once your body becomes dependent, you have a chemical dependency. And that becomes a lust, and then you have that drug abuse and alcohol abuse. And then there's also criminal lust. There are some people who lust to be criminals. And boy, do I ever know this from watching a lot of ID shows. It's what my dad likes a lot of. And these criminals, sometimes it's as if their whole thing in life is to get away with something. And to run from the police. I remember this one guy was on there. He was getting all sorts of money, and he had a way of talking to people. He said he was from the army, and he got all this praise from people, and he was meeting all these women on the internet and saying that he was an army person, and he would meet them and start taking their money, And then finally he even got a lady at a bank. He bought a house for $300,000, and he's a criminal. And his whole thing was, and he was a nobody. I'm like, man, how did he do this? He was buying brand new cars right and left. And he figured out how to work the system. And man, this guy, and then the police would come after him. And that was just a big rush for him. He'd start running. Then he'd have an emotional letdown and call his mommy. They're after me. And then he'd figure, oh, I got to get away. And then he'd start running and get away. And they'd say, well, just turn yourself in. No, I've got to get away. And that was his whole thing in life. That's a criminal lust. And a lot of people don't have that. But that was his area of weakness. And there are criminals who are believers. And that's why the Apostle Paul said, stop stealing. If you're stealing, stop stealing. If you're doing this, stop doing it. Because there are criminal believers who need to stop being criminal. And they have a criminal lust. And a lot of that is linked up with the chemical lust too. So they get that lust, they need the money. Anyway, that's all part of a lot of the degeneration that's going on in this country today as well. But we'll close up there and get back with distractions tomorrow night. So with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, Father, we thank you for the wonderful privilege and opportunity of studying these things. May God the Holy Spirit enlighten us and challenge us concerning what we've noted. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen.